Welcome to Season 3 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Josh Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former Secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. With vaccinations rising and cases declining in the United States, what comes next? How do we turn progress into the end of the pandemic? Today, Dr. Josh Sharfstein speaks to Dr. Crystal Watson and Dr. Caitlin Rivers, senior scholars at the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security, to find out. Let's listen.
Dr. Crystal Watson, Dr. Caitlin Rivers, thanks so much for coming to talk to me. Our topic is what it will take to really put an end to the pandemic. We're seeing a lot of progress with vaccinations, but we're also seeing signs that vaccinations alone on the current pace that we're on may not be enough. I'll start with you, Dr. Watson. When you see the numbers these days, what are you thinking about the trajectory of the pandemic in the United States?
I'm very encouraged by the level of vaccination that we've seen so far, especially in older populations. I think we see a really clear negative correlation between high vaccination rates and infection rates in specific age groups. And so that is very encouraging, but there's been a lot in the news recently about the slowdown in demand for vaccination that we're seeing in a lot of places around the country. And so I think the trajectory really is we're going to have to work a lot harder to get new segments of the population vaccinated in the next couple of months. It's been easy so far. There's been a lot of demand, but now is the time to really put in a lot of effort to reach people, meet people where they are in the community, allay their concerns, and really try to get as high coverage as we can.
Got it. Now, Dr. Rivers, is vaccination pretty much the sole focus right now of public health programs, or what else would you add to the list of city administrators, health officials who really want to put this pandemic in the rearview mirror?
Vaccination is certainly one of the primary lines of effort, but I think there is still a role for community mitigation. The benefit of driving community transmission down is you get a lot more flexibility to reopen things that have been restricted, maybe be a little bit more flexible around masks. But nonetheless, I do think there are still a role for those kinds of what we call non-pharmaceutical interventions. Limitations on indoor gatherings, for example, I think should remain in place. Indoor mask mandates, I think, should remain in place until we're able to get transmission to much lower levels.
Dr. Watson, what else besides vaccination can communities do to reduce transmission? We heard about from Dr. Rivers masking, for example. Are there other public health strategies?
Yeah, I've focused a lot on contact tracing over the last year. And I do think if ever there was a time for contact tracing to play a big role in our response, now is the time. As we bring infection rates down in our communities, then it will be easier for investigators and public health agencies to find as many cases as possible and then trace their contacts, ask them to quarantine and provide them support in quarantine so that we can further reduce transmission. And it's kind of a reinforcing cycle there. It will also be helpful later, even later on in the pandemic, as we have very low rates of transmission and hopefully very high vaccination levels, to find cases that are imported into the country or imported from different states and cut them off quickly so we don't have new epidemics and people who are still naive to the infection.
I know there was a big interest last year in really scaling up contact tracing, but that did not happen in most places. Is the availability of funds different now that some of this legislation has passed? Do you think that health departments will have the ability to do more contact tracing and shut down transmission faster?
Yeah, so there was a pretty big scale up of contact tracing around the country, not enough to really make a difference In especially in times of really high transmission in the fall and winter surge, it wasn't the tool to control transmission at that point. But I do think one limiting factor was funding. They did get some, states did get some funding from the CARES Act and other legislation from Congress to do contact tracing. But what I've heard from many public health departments is that it wasn't enough. And they had to go basically into their coffers or into the red in order to do contact tracing. And some just didn't have the money to do that. I think now there's a lot more money available to states to do contact tracing and localities. And the Biden administration has just initiated a new public health jobs initiative with about $7.6 billion in funding, which will help hopefully in the near term for contact tracing, but also will help over the long term to sustainably hire public health workers to do all sorts of jobs, not just pandemic response.
Got it. Now, Dr. Rivers, testing. I haven't talked about testing yet. I remember a time when all we could talk about was testing. What's the role of testing in putting out the COVID fire here in the United States?
There are three main kinds of testing, and I think they will all continue to play a role well past this phase of the pandemic. Diagnostic testing, identifying whether someone with symptoms is infected, will continue to be a mainstay. If you're having COVID symptoms, you should still receive a diagnostic test. The other big kind of testing is screening testing, and this is particularly important in schools, institutions of incarceration, other places where people are in constant contact with one another. Screening testing tests people once or twice a week to identify outbreaks. I think that will play a really important role in places that have low levels of vaccine coverage, like schools where children are not able to get vaccinated. And the third kind is surveillance testing, and that's more of a research endeavor.
Where do you think we are right now in terms of adequate access to testing compared to what we would need to be able to do to have the most impact on the pandemic?
I'm quite pleased with the level of available testing. Our test positivity is low nationally, which indicates that we're doing enough diagnostic testing. And there's been a lot of movement to bring screening testing into those kinds of group settings, although we're not quite done implementing that to the best of our ability. I think the biggest challenge is reaching people who may not have easy access to testing, underserved communities, communities of color. I think there still needs to be a lot of emphasis to bring testing and make it available to places that may not otherwise easily access it.
Got it. Okay, so let's say there are places that are going to follow your recipe for controlling the pandemic, really work on getting the vaccine out there, overcoming hesitancy, answering people's questions. And at the same time, they're going to be doing contact tracing. They're going to have a rigorous testing program. They're going to maintain their mask mandates for indoors while there are still cases. And they start to see results and you start to see cases going down. When is it okay to say the pandemic's over? And I'm going to ask this in two ways. First is the official way, like at what point do you declare the pandemic over? But the other way is sort of the personal way. I know how much work both of you have put into the coronavirus response over the last year. When for you will, what will it look like for you to say that this kind of pandemic is now a matter of, study and history? Dr. Rivers.
I think when case counts fall to very low levels, maybe 1 to 3 cases per 100,000 per day, we can feel that we've put it behind us. Now, that's not to say we won't have hotspots or maybe resurgences in the winter, but when we get to that level of transmission, things start to look very different.
Dr. Watson, any thoughts on that point?
Yeah, I agree with Dr. Rivers on that. But I do think that we probably won't get to that point for quite some time globally. And so while we may look like a non-pandemic country, hopefully towards the end of this year, I think the world will continue to be in a pandemic. And so we certainly can't declare it ended until we see that kind of reduction in transmission across the world, because not only does it affect the world, but if we have those levels of transmission internationally, we're going to see cases be imported to the U.S. continually. And we may have the emergence of additional variants of concern that make the pandemic worse in the coming year or so. So we certainly have to be on our guard for a while, even if the U.S. looks better.
A great point, particularly now as we're seeing some of the worst levels of the pandemic in different parts of the globe. Is there anything in particular you imagine that you'll do when the pandemic is past? Any other work project, anything that for you will signify that this kind of phase of intense focus is behind you?
First thing I want to do is take a vacation and travel internationally. I've missed travel enormously. And so that will probably be one of the first things I do. But it would be nice also to get back to more routine work in terms of pandemic preparedness and learning the lessons from this pandemic. I think that will be a big focus for a long time for us, for our center at Johns Hopkins and me personally.
Great. Dr. Rivers, anything to add?
I echo both points. Dr. Watson, I am looking forward to taking a nice rest. And if there is a beach involved, all the better. But also when we move from response phase to really thinking deeply about how to make sure we're never caught in this position again, I think will mark a change in my perspective of the work at hand.
Great. Well, thanks to you both for everything you've done during the pandemic and will continue to do until we get to that point.
Thank you.
Good to be with you.
Public Health On Call is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo and Neiman Outlin. Social media support from Brenda Hageter, Grace Holes Fernandez, and Caroline Wong. Thank you for listening.